Hello everyone. Today our topic in operating system course is communication in client server systems using sockets. In the previous two videos, we discussed two models for inter-process communication, shared memory and message passing. In shared memory model, shared memory region or area is used for communication, while in message passing facility is used for communication. In shared memory, no kernel assistance is needed. In message passing, kernel assistance is required. In shared memory, the code for read-write the data from the shared memory should be written by the application program. While in message passing, no such code is required as the message passing facility provides mechanism for communication and synchronization of actions performed by the communicating processes. Shared memory strategy is used on a single processor or multiple processor systems where the communicating processes reside in the same machine. Message passing is suitable for distributed systems where communicating processes reside on remote machines connected through a network. Message passing is slower than shared memory, but it's more efficient for a small amount of data. These two strategies can be used for communicating in client-server systems as well. In addition to these models, three other strategies for communicating in client-server systems are used: sockets, remote procedure calls, and pipes. A socket is defined as an endpoint for communication. A connection between a pair of applications consists of a pair of sockets, one at each end of the communication channel. Remote procedure calls are used when a process calls a procedure on a remote application. Ordinary pipes allow communication between parent and child processes, while named pipes permit unrelated processes to communicate. Today we are going to discuss communication in client-server systems using sockets. And in the next meetings, we will discuss the other two strategies. A socket is defined as an endpoint for communication. A connection between a pair of applications consists of a pair of sockets, one at each end of the communication channel. A socket is identified by an IP address concatenated with a port number. The server waits for incoming client requests by listening to a specified port. Once a request is received, the server accepts a connection from the client socket to complete the connection. Server implementing a specific services listen to a well-known ports. For example, a Telnet server listens to port 23, an FTP server listens to port 21, a web server listens to port 80. These port numbers cannot be assigned to client processes. Really, not only these numbers, but all ports below 1024 are considered well known. We can use them to implement standard services only. So the ports up to 1024 are reserved for standard services. Suppose that the client has the IP address 164.86.5.20 and the web server has the web address 161.25.19.8. In order to communicate, the host or client and the server should have a communication link. Initially, the server creates a socket and it's created using the IP address and the port in this case 80, since it's a web server. The socket in the server is attached to a network port addresses, then it waits for the client to contact it. The client creates a socket and then attempts to connect to the server. The socket is created by assigning a port, for example, 1625, and the port should be greater than 1024, and this port is concatenated with the IP address to form the socket. On the server, port 80 is listening to the network, so when the connection is established, a transfer of data takes place. All connections must be unique. If another process, for example, B2 on host X, wishes to establish another connection with the same server, it would be assigned a port number greater than 1024, but not equal to 1625. This ensures that all connections consist of a unique pair of sockets. Communication using sockets, although common and efficient, is considered a low-level form of communication between distributed processes. One reason is that sockets allow only an unstructured stream of bytes to be exchanged between the communicating processes. It is the responsibility of the client or server application to impose a structure on the data. In the next meetings, we'll discuss two higher methods of communication, remote procedure calls and pipes. For today, that's all. Thank you.